Although it's an entirely normal and natural process on Earth, flooding represents a huge problem for people. Every year, we collectively throw billions of dollars essentially into the trash because of flood damage to property, buildings, vehicles, and equipment. But it's not just private property that's affected. Nearly every part of the constructed environment is vulnerable in some way to heavy rainfall. Culverts, bridges, sewers, canals, dams, and drainage infrastructure, they all have to be designed to withstand at least some amount of flooding. But how do we decide how much is enough, and how do we estimate the magnitude of any particular storm event? Hey, I'm Grady, and this is Practical Engineering. On today's episode, we're talking about synthetic floods for designing infrastructure. This video is sponsored by HelloFresh, America's number one meal kit. More on that later. A big portion of the constructed environment has at least something to do with drainage. If it's exposed to the outdoors, and almost all infrastructure is, it's going to get wet or deal with some water. Designers and engineers have to be thoughtful about how and where that water will go during a storm. This might seem self-evident, but someone had to decide how long to make this storm drain inlet, how high above the river to build this bridge, how wide to make this spillway, and how big to build this culvert. And these types of decisions aren't arbitrary, because infrastructure is expensive, and it's always built on a budget. You can't waste dollars installing pipes that are too big, bridges that are too high, or spillways too wide, because then that money can't be used to fund other projects or improvements. But how much is too much? After all, if you can imagine a flood that meets the capacity of a given structure, you can probably imagine a bigger one that exceeds it. On one hand, you have the structure's cost, and on the other, you have its capacity. In other words, its ability to withstand flooding. Finding a balance point between the two is a really important job, and it usually has to do with statistics. Weather is sporadic. It's noisy data. Some days it rains, some days it doesn't. Some years it rains nearly every day, and some years not at all. But behind all that noise, there is a hidden beauty to weather data, which is the relationship between a storm's magnitude and its probability. Small storms happen all the time, multiple times a year. Big storms happen rarely, only every few years. Massive floods occur only once every tens or hundreds of years. Their probability of occurring in a given year is low. This is all relative, of course, especially depending on the location. But I hope you're seeing why this matters. Because if you know the probability a particular storm will occur, you also know the average number of times it will happen over a given period of time. And why does that matter? Let's use a simple case as an example. Say you have a roadway crossing a stream and you want to install a culvert. By the way, if you want to learn more about culverts, check out my video on that topic after this. Say you choose a tiny pipe for your culvert to save some money. That's fiscal responsibility, right? But every time even a small amount of rain comes along, the culvert's capacity will be exceeded, and the roadway will overtop and wash out. Your cheap pipe actually ends up being pretty expensive when you have to replace it every year. On the other hand, you can go for broke on a massive pipe that never gets full, even during huge rainstorms. You'll never have to replace it, but you wasted money by building a much bigger structure than was necessary. That might not seem like a big deal for a single culvert, but if it's your policy to do it every time you have to cross a stream, you'll run out of money in a hurry. We can't just overbuild all our infrastructure to avoid any exposure to flood risk. Usually the most cost-effective solution is somewhere in the middle, where you're willing to accept some risk of being overwhelmed. Maybe on average it will happen once every 10 years or once every 50 years, to save the cost of overbuilding every single piece of drainage infrastructure. This works the same way as the floodplain, the area along coasts and rivers most likely to be impacted by flooding. In the US, at least, we arbitrarily decided to use 1% as the dividing line between at-risk for flooding and not. If the land has a 1% probability or greater of being inundated by a flood in a given year, it's inside the quote-unquote floodplain. And the storm that would completely flood this floodplain is colloquially called the 100-year flood. That's a confusing name, and I made a video on that topic quite a while back, so I won't rehash it here. This binary approach of drawing a line in the sand is also a little misleading because it implies this area is safe and this area isn't, when the reality is there's a continuum of flood risk. Those considerations aside, the concept of the floodplain is still really valuable. Knowing our vulnerability to flooding helps us make good decisions about how to manage or mitigate it. But actually figuring out that vulnerability is pretty challenging. The truth is that the only way we have to estimate how vulnerable different areas are to flooding is to look at how they flooded in the past. In the US, we do have a network of stream gauges, dutifully recording the level of creeks and rivers, and some of them have been doing so for over 100 years now. These instruments record the magnitude of floods through history so we can try to understand the relationship between the size of a flood and its frequency of recurring. But these stream gauges are relatively expensive, time-consuming to maintain, and their data is only applicable to the watershed in which they're installed, which means not every location you might want to build something has a historical flood record to review. However, there is a type of instrument that does exist practically everywhere with long-duration historical records, a rain gauge. Rain gauges are simple and cheap, and luckily, in the US, our government has seen fit to collect huge volumes of rainfall data, synthesize it, and provide the information back to us citizens for our practical application or just for our curiosity. The latest version of this is called Atlas 14, and you can use the online web map to get statistical relationships between rainfall volume, duration, and probability for nearly everywhere in the US. But estimating the magnitude of a flood doesn't stop with knowing how much rain is falling from the sky. It may not surprise you to know that the 100-year storm doesn't really exist. It's a synthetic storm event, invented by engineers and hydrologists. We fabricate it by taking that statistical amount of rain for a given watershed and use models to estimate how much flooding will result and where that flooding will occur within the landscape. These simulations allow us to understand flood risks, so we know where not to build our buildings, how big to make our culverts, how tall to make our bridges, and how wide to make our drainage channels. But flooding doesn't just cost money. It also affects public safety. In fact, some of the worst floods in history, like the Johnstown flood in Pennsylvania, actually occurred because a storm overwhelmed a dam, causing it to fail and release a sudden wave of water downstream. In that case, over 2,000 people lost their lives. With critical infrastructure like this, the calculus changes because it's not just dollars on the other side of the balance, it's also human lives. We are much less willing to accept the risk of overwhelming a dam if there are people who could be affected downstream. So how do we know how big spillways should be? Turns out there's another type of synthetic flood in the toolbox, the probable maximum precipitation. This is the most extreme rainstorm that could ever occur given our knowledge of meteorology and atmospheric science. If all the factors perfectly align to carry and drop the maximum amount of rainfall in the shortest period of time, could our infrastructure withstand it? In the case of dams, the answer is usually yes. That's because they're required to. We've spent lots of time, money, and effort researching storms to estimate this probable maximum precipitation across the US for this exact reason, so we can build spillways big enough to safely discharge it without being overwhelmed. The field of engineering hydrology is huge. Many engineers focus their entire careers on this one topic that we've just dipped our toes into. Flooding is one of the biggest challenges of building and developing the modern world. The ways we deal with it are constantly evolving, hopefully in a direction that puts greater emphasis on natural watershed processes and ecosystem services. But no matter how we deal with it, the first step will always be to understand our vulnerability to it. I hope this video gave you a little peek into the world of water resources engineering and how we make good decisions about infrastructure's ability to handle flooding. It's time again for everyone's favorite segment of watching me try to cook while my wife tries to capture that on video, now while managing the baby too. I'm not much of a culinary mastermind, but I do love to spend time with the family in the kitchen. That's why we're thankful for HelloFresh, the sponsor of this video, for converting cooking from a chore into our favorite thing to do on date night.
Well, I mean, if you mangle it like that. I'm just kidding, that looks good.
HelloFresh delivers seasonal recipes and pre-measured ingredients right to your door. We get the vegetarian meals, and they're always delicious. It's an awesome way to try new foods, especially healthy and fresh stuff that we aren't always great about including in our usual cooking.
Yay, kale! That's the only time you're gonna hear mommy say those words.
The pre-portioned ingredients means there's less prep and less food waste, and the packaging is mostly recyclable or already recycled content. HelloFresh also helps us get dinner ready quickly on the days we just don't have time for planning, prep, and shopping, especially with how distractible we are these days.
What are you guys doing?
Go try it yourself by using my code 80PRACTICAL to get $80 off across 5 boxes, including free shipping with your first box. Supporting our sponsors helps support this channel. That's HelloFresh.com and use code 80PRACTICAL. Thank you for watching, and let me know what you think.